everybody, welcome to Wednesday on Hyper RPG. It's me, your overlord, and this is on my right.
I was throwing it to you.
Scott.
It's a lob. The ball's in your court.
I'm that bronze girl, a variety caster on Twitch and a comic book enthusiast and self-professed neckbeard.
Wait, hold on a sec. A self-professed neckbeard?
Yeah.
Why would you do that to yourself?
Because I am. At some point, you just have to learn to accept it, where you're like, I'm a little bit of an elitist sometimes. Okay. I can be douchey with my opinions. I don't like change. Those are all like the tenets.
No, I mean, you're not saying anything that's untrue at all in any way, but to label yourself something.
It's just embracing it, you know? It's just
embracing neckbeard. Mm-hmm. We have a very anti-neckbeard policy here.
Oh, I guess I should.
Well, I was going to announce that you're going to be an official host on our show, but now it's awkward. We just discovered something about you. That, I mean, we knew. We just didn't put a name to it. Now there's a name to it.
I'll wait for the pink slip.
It's been cool. Yeah. It's been cool. No, I mean this is... It's, here. Fire. On that note, this is the first week of you as official host on the show with me.
I'm here to stay.
And starting next week, it will not be this show anymore. It's not. It's going to be something else. So, as you guys know that have been watching this week, Rabbit Stew is officially canceled. Bye. That's how we send things out. Get the fuck out the door. You're done. You're out. Bye.
That was about to happen to me a few seconds ago.
A few seconds ago. Now it's going to be 20 minutes later. So, Rabbit Stew's done, and we are replacing it with our 10 a.m. shows, moving up to 1 p.m. so we can focus more on having fun, entertaining you guys. But the comic book show stays. It just won't be called Rabbit Stew anymore. We need to come up with a name. We have nothing good so far, so I'm going to leave it up to you guys in the audience to pitch us some, and maybe we'll pick one. So far, Ryan threw out the name Comic Relief, and we thought that was stupid.
It's a little dad jokey or punny.
Right.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, Bronze Girl's super kind of like punk. What about Comic Vomit? And then everybody's like, no, that's also bad. So why don't we leave it up to you guys? Pitch us some names, and then next week you're going to have a new show. There will be no more Anime Mondays, guys. Here's the deal. And we'll talk about it on Honesty Hour tonight. We'll get really deep into it. But, like, we know that some of you guys like this stuff. You like some of the shows that we do, and you watch them very religiously, and we love that you do. Unfortunately, as a company, because we're not solo streamers, you know, like, we don't have the liberty sometimes to just chill and take things easy, because we're losing money, in fact, by doing so. So, we have the numbers now. We've been able to collect data for a while, and we tried changing things up. We tried fixing things. We tried moving things around. And at the end of the day, when you see something in your business is just losing you a lot of money, you got to get rid of it. And that's just the hard truth of that. But luckily, the comic book segment does fairly well. And we're going to retool it, see if it works. And then a month or two later, I'll cancel it, too. And then we'll...
Oh, no, I'm just kidding. Keep supporting us!
That's the big thing, is everybody just has to keep
for
supporting.
For just one support a day, you can keep your Bronze Girl on your local comic book internet show.
There you go. There you go.
Just one support a day.
One support a day. Look at that. Somebody just threw out the name, maybe just Graphic.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Graphic's actually kind of cool, because we're very not politically correct sometimes, which is unfortunate, but true.
And I cuss a lot.
I do, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, fuck this, fuck that. This is fucking stupid. Blah 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 blah. Graphic's a good name. We're gonna write that. I'm gonna write it down. Just Graphic.
I
love double slash triple meanings of things. It's just great. I wrote that down. Thank you. Thank you for that. Replace every show with DFA or Shadowrun. That's not how it works in Minker. Shut up. It's way more complicated than that, and you know it is. Don't be a troll. Don't be a troll. Show about comic books. You know that's a good one too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just show about comic books.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm actually a really big fan of redundant, pointless titles.
Really?
Oh my god, yeah. On my old channel, Aren't We Clever, it was the Aren't We Clever Super Fun Time, Totally Awesome. Oh my god, I forgot the rest of the title. There was like two more sentences in there.
For a second, I thought the Oh My God, I Forgot the Rest of the Title was part of the title.
That would have been pretty cool. Super fun time. Awesome. Oh my God, I can't remember it all. I'm actually kind of glad I don't remember it. It shows that there's been stuff that's happened in between there.
Mm-hmm.
That's
been displaced by more important like information.
Yeah. Yeah. But I like pointless titles. All of my art shows back when I did art shows back in the day were all really long, redundant titles that were really stupid just because I wanted people to have to print them.
Yeah.
And that was like my little troll. I've always been a troll, guys. I'm a big fan. Big fan of trolling, especially the media. Especially the media. Did I ever tell you guys, this is my first time watching this show. Oh, well, hello, Boomstick Weather Witch. Eventually, we'll get into talking about comic books.
It'll happen. Just wait for it.
Yep. We'll get there. I actually read a couple this morning in between pain meds and really enjoyed a couple.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get to them.
Mm-hmm.
But the big one for me was like Faith Number One came out this week.
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about that for sure.
Yeah. Did you like it?
Somebody said, how about Off the Rack? That just, then you just think boobs.
I was going like to say that. Better. Or you think like a clothing rack.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like... Yeah, it's yeah, too booby, too booby. I don't have Scott and I are a little lacking in that department, so it doesn't flow as well. But I really liked Faith Number One, and we're definitely gonna talk about that. What's your big takeaway this week that you want to talk about later?
Helena Bertinelli as the new Huntress.
Mm.
Yeah. Yep.
Cool. We'll talk about that, and I won't know anything about you're talking about. I'm going to take 100% of your word.
I'll fill you in.
You're just going to have to fill me in and keep me up to speed, because I've actually never read a Birds of Prey book.
Oh, really?
Yep. Never. I don't tread over to the DC side too often. When I do, it's usually for like the key titles, and somebody's like, dude, read Swamp Thing. I'm like, read Batman. I'll do it. Fine. Or, you know, this Animal Man right now is really good. I'll go check it out. But it's usually just those specific really good books.
You have the feeling where you really need to sneeze, but you can't sneeze?
All the time. It's
happening to me right now. So if it looks like I'm having a seizure or something, or stroke.
If your eyes start watering and like shaking.
Yeah, it's not because I'm going to cry. It's because I need to sneeze and I can't.
I know that this is a really emotional time. You just found out you're going to get fired a little bit ago, so. But then rehired for our new show starting next Wednesday at 1 p.m. Next Wednesday, 1 p.m. This will just be the same old. There might be some changes because... by effectively losing Rabbit Stew, we will, it allows us to open up some time that we can put towards making this show better. Having more guests, more research, things like that. I'll probably run it a little bit more like my last comic book show, and that will be a little bit more prepared to talk about certain topics and yada, 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 yada. More work for this in particular, but it'll be fun.
It's going to be completely scripted is what he's saying. There's going to be a teleprompter.
Oh, God.
And my opinions will not be my own anymore.
Oh, yeah. Because we totally have the time to write shit. Anytime somebody like comes into our one of our RPG shows and goes, scripted, bullshit, totally scripted. I'm like, yeah, because, yeah, we have
no, I can vouch for the fact that it's not. They're just like, on DFA, you guys were just like, okay, this is your character, go. And I was like, oh, my God.
You'd probably expect it to be more scripted.
Yeah,
you put a lot
of
faith in spontaneity, which is scary.
I totally thought you guys were going to be like, oh, we want you to hit these three things. Nope. They're like, get in there.
You almost killed one of our key players.
And I was like, sweet, I'm going to duel that dude right there. And you guys were like, sure, go ahead. Kill the motherfucker.
Yeah.
Slaughter him, chop him into pieces, throw him in the river.
Now you see the danger of us doing things that way. It's really nerve-wracking, but it's exciting for us. Like, it's more fun for us to be spontaneous and reactive. Like, I think that's part of what's really exciting about Twitch, is you get to be reactive instead of... When I first started doing Twitch, it really freaked me out because I came from a production world, and it was like everything had to be planned because you're wasting money if something isn't planned and you're spending time trying to figure it out. But once it starts and you're there on live, it's out there, and it's kind of exciting and freeing in a weird way. It's like running around naked in public. Whoa, whatever happens. That's how it feels to me. But yeah, thank you for almost killing off one of our key players.
Yeah, you're welcome. You're welcome.
Appreciate that. So, coming up today on the channel, we've got all sorts of exciting stuff. We actually have an interview today. We have an interview this afternoon with Greg Wilson, the creator of Icarus. We'll be showing you guys a Kickstarter later. It's going to be a lot of cool stuff. I read his books. Did you get a chance to read it?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
It's really cool, right?
It's beautiful.
It's different.
Yeah, I like it.
I like the world building.
Yeah, I get confused sometimes, but I think that's the point.
Well, yeah. It's a little heady. You can tell he was a novelist.
Yeah, but it's good.
That's definitely good. Cesar12, hello. Thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. And for anyone who's thinking about following, if you're new and you're tuning in for the first time, hi, how's it going? What's up? Throw us a follow.
I see you.
What's going on,
welcome,
man?
Welcome to the Hyper RPG ASMR channel.
Hello.
for following, we will treat you to 15 seconds of ASMR.
He's going to talk to them about how much my face hurts.
Everything hurts really bad.
I feel so bad for you because tooth
it's
pain
fine.
Is like the worst thing in the whole world.
Though. I'm used to nerve pain. Like, I live through chronic nerve pain every day of my life. Oh. What I don't like is when something takes over my brain, like, function.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because the thing that I can't stand more than anything is not being able to think quickly. Mm-hmm. Like, my job and everything that I do in my life requires me to have to think on the fly. And when I'm, like, at one point, I know Emily was asking me something today, and then I caught myself doing this. Wait.
The I can't even face.
What? Fuck. And then I get angry. I get actually mad because I'm like, I have to be able to think quickly and on my feet and then fake it on camera while I'm out here and think, I feel great. So if I get a call and I leave and make you do the show yourself, it's because they found a person to do surgery for me. And the second that happens, I'm out because I need to fix my face. It's fucking killing me. It's driving me crazy. I haven't fucking slept for days. And now is when I start ranting like an old man about, fuck it.
Get off my lawn.
And after that, we've got Watching Paint Dry at 3 p.m. today.
Yes.
And that's going to be a lot of fun. I believe Steph's coming by. They're going to paint some mechs. And then we've got Shadowrun Corporate Sins in Back to School. Our runners are hired to investigate attacks by the Yakuza on a corpse shipments to find out who has been passing on information to the gang. Sounds like fun. And of course, Lauren set them in a school. This is right up her alley. And then later tonight at 10 p.m., it's going to be Honesty Hour. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of this thing that we do?
Yeah.
We'll probably have you come on sometime.
Oh, goodness.
And I'll give you a couple drinks first so we can get you to be as rambunctious as you were after.
I get a little rambunctious. I'm not going to lie. I'm a feisty lady.
I will fucking fight you.
I said that.
And then you threw something on the ground and it was like, and then Joe in the background was like, I'll fight you. And you're like, I'll fucking fight you. And walked over to my...
Let's go, Joe, right now.
So, tonight we will be talking about a lot of stuff, the changes to the channel, all the things that have been going on. I haven't had one in a while, so you guys kind of feel out of the loop, and I've had people messaging me, and it's like, I can't talk to you guys one-on-one like all like the time. So we'll do Honesty Hour. I'll update you guys on everything. We have some cool announcements, and yeah, all that kind of stuff. So make sure you stick around for that. And that's basically the rundown on all that good stuff. That's what's happening today. And as per usual, every 5 subscribers, we give away a Steam key to the audience. We have our next big subscriber goal is every 50. So when we get to 1,200 subscribers, we'll be doing a massive giveaway filled with all sorts of great stuff that we have lying around here. And we will ship it to you anywhere in the world. And it's a really cool thing. So you guys should subscribe to get that happening. And if we get to 1,500 subscribers before the end of the summer, we're going to do a camp party in the studio.
What?
We're going to build tents. We've got a little fake fireplace. We're going to tell stories, ghost stories, do some board games. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be really cool.
And I'll fight Joe for your entertainment.
And you'll fight Joe for our entertainment.
In a gladiator ring.
Cool. We'll build that.
Yeah.
For sure.
Mm-hmm. To the death. I will kill him.
Thank you, Zinstay, for that resubscription. Thank you so much. And the other thing is when we get to 1,500 subscribers, we will be releasing a merch store.
Oh.
So I kind of want us to get to a certain point to even do it because it's a lot of work to set it up and to get it out there. And I also don't want to like work really hard on something, put it out there, and then have it just sit there. So I kind of want to know that we've got a bigger base built up before we put it out. Otherwise, it's just going to make us sad whenever we look at it. And it's like...
Failure.
Yeah, right? Which is happens sometimes. So that's pretty much it. Tune in tonight to hear about all the stuff going on the channel, talk about the new shows and all that good stuff and things that we have planned and announcements and all that good stuff. So, but now we talk about comic books, damn it.
We get heated about it.
Yeah. Graphic,
passionate.
Right? I do like graphic or graphic content.
Yes.
Somebody said graphic content
as well. I like
graphic. Well.
I think that might be. And buzzword. You said I was punk, so that could even... Yeah.
I guess you're a neckbeard, actually. I thought you were punk, but you're just a neckbeard, which is way fucking worse. I have respect for punks.
No, I'm just
a
neckbeard.
Yeah.
Streamies.
Just mouth breathing all the time.
Streamies.
Zach, what are the Streamies. So, thank you for that resubscribe. Thank you for that. Streamies or Riot. So basically, guys, if you go to our Facebook page or Twitter, you will see a link that leads you to the Streamies. We have entered the Streamies, and you should definitely help us out if you like what we do. I think that we're pushing live content extremely far forward and that we're doing all sorts of crazy stuff. There's not even categories for the shit that we do at the Streamies. It's kind of built for more traditional forms of content for YouTube and stuff like that. But we still want to try to do it because we are a small what? There's a new category for fan nominations only, and if you click the link that we have in chat, that has already filled out, and they can just put their information in, and it's their vote. Did I do that right, Emily?
Yeah, it was word for word verbatim.
I know. That was word for word verbatim. You should tell them that. So, that's basically the gist of it all. As Emily just said, through me to you. You can vote. It's already filled out. You just got to click the link and just submit. There you go. Oh, what about Vanquish? We're getting there. We're getting there. Hold on. Having one of those moments. I want like a semi truck to come like crashing through the building and hitting me right here. Like that would be great. Just end it right there. Just
hey,
this side of the face.
Maybe
the right
in that moment, I would like react, and that's when my superhero powers would activate.
Mm.
Maybe I could like reach out and like stop the truck.
Yeah.
Because I have to be put in that situation for them to activate, and I've never been in that situation. So I actually
never been in a life or death situation.
No. So I
the way you talked a couple weeks ago, you would think that you've been in some deep shit. Because you talked mad game.
Well,
you were like, I'm tough as shit.
I have been in deep shit, but my life wasn't the one that was in danger.
Oh. Total neckbeard. I'm really strong and tough. I've seen some shit, man. My life's rough. You don't know.
Women just don't love me because I'm in the friend zone. That's the reason.
It's hard.
Because women only like assholes. That's why they don't like me.
It's hard being a white male in America.
Yeah, it is. Where's my fedora? Why'd you guys confiscate it at the door? It's so wrong. Men can't even be classy these days. Gosh. Humphrey Bogart wore one.
Yeah. Boom. So, totally fine. So let's recap Vanquished. Now, we're going to start that recap. And it's funny you mentioned that's how your powers kind of ignited is through some traumatic situation, like a semi-truck crashing through the building here. Mm-hmm. I'd like to announce here on this show that bronze girl will be joining us for the next 2 weeks on Valiant Vanquished.
Yep.
As the secret informant that Galushi is planting in the compound. Now, I've got to update on you on all this stuff after the show because you're going to have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about.
Nope, I don't.
Nope, you just know you're on the show.
Yeah, I'm just really good at nodding and pretending like
mm-hmm.
I do now.
Mm-hmm. We cleared that you're on the show. Mm-hmm. It just, I hadn't had the episode yet, so I didn't know who you were going to be. But now that episode's over, and I can say, oh, okay, now there's a plan. There's a plan in place.
Yay!
So, not so secret now. That's right. So Scott's going to be out of town. He's not here today because he's in Europe. And while Scott's out of town, that bronze girl is going to be on the show, filling in for Scott. Not as Scott's character though. You're going to be your own character.
I'm my own person.
Yeah. Basically.
I know I'm sitting in Scott's chair and I'm like filling in for Scott on the show, but I'm my own person. Mm-hmm. I'm not Scott. I know I have a neck beard, and he also has a beard, and that confuses people, but we're not the same
person.
Oh, but
he's not a neck
beard.
He's actually really progressive, though. He's not a neck
beard. That's why I didn't call him a neck beard. I said he has a beard.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm the angry neck beard, not Scott.
Sprofright says, I hope you like punching people in the dick, because currently they're called Team Dick Punch.
I could wrap my brain around that, I think.
And for the people asking about questions about Rabbit Stew and where's Claudia and blah, blah, and all this, come to Honesty Hour tonight and we'll talk about all that stuff. Now we're just going to talk about comic books and we're going to talk about Vanquished. So, on Monday's episode, we saw our, I never want to call them heroes because it just doesn't make sense. They're not heroes yet. They're not even close to heroes. And honestly, they performed a couple things that were very non-heroic last week.
Oh no.
Now, they thought they were being heroic because Galushi told them to kill These people, basically, they started off exactly where they left off at the end of this prison where Eves has agreed to go off with Dr. Silk to get closer to Petunia because she's having some like really fucked up withdrawal symptoms from being away from Petunia. And we started off right where that left off, and Glushi asked them to burn the helicopter and make their way north to a cabin where there's two heat signatures in this cabin a couple miles north, eliminate them, collect some like clothes and stuff, and wait to hear from him. And then immediately after that, he got attacked by PRS, Glushi did, and he set his entire house on fire in a really epic kind of like way. So that was pretty cool. That was pretty cool. I thought that was fun. They made their way to this cabin, and we met up with Kate Johnson and Whiskey-Eyed Raccoon, who were two gay libertarians, basically, living in the middle of the woods, celebrating their rights as Americans and freedom, and were a little bit like backwater redneck, but in a very progressive way, because they wanted to escape society and live free of persecution as two gay men that love each other. And that was pretty fun, and Glushi kept saying to kill them, so there were no witnesses left over and nobody that could talk, and they thought they were doing the heroic thing by letting them live. And when they ran away, a helicopter was landing, and they didn't go back and save them. They chose to let them die. So they effectively didn't. They didn't kill them, but they definitely rode away and didn't even bat an eyelash and go, maybe we should go help them. Nobody in the group even asked that question of like, should we go help them? Should we? No,
they didn't
just
kill them,
they're on their own.
They let them die.
Basically, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, they're not very heroic. They're not superheroes even close. Not even close. Then they found out from Glushi at a diner next to an airport that Eves is being held at Alcatraz, and the PRS has built a giant facility underneath Alcatraz that is the most difficult thing they've ever gone up against. They are completely outclassed and very, very way over their heads. And that's where you come in, because you are Galushi's special undercover agent helping him out, who's supposed to be a little bit more prepared for the things that they're about to face. But we've got to talk about all that stuff after the show, because
I
holy
could see
shit.
Myself being an undercover agent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting.
I'm pretty efficient and, you know, cool headed. So.
Oh, okay. Cool headed. Definitely don't have a temper.
No, not at all. I would say that I am probably the most calmest, most collected person I know. Even when people are okay with Tony Stark being replaced as Iron Man, I tend to keep a cool, logical thought process
definitely.
At all times. Yes, that is me.
Yep, yep. Your argumentation style is definitely not, you are wrong!
Pointing at people and screaming they are wrong is not what I do. No, no. That does not sound like me at all.
Right, right. So basically, there's all sorts of crazy stuff that's going to go down next Monday. You guys definitely do not want to miss that. They're trying to save Eves. They're trying to save Petunia. They haven't even asked about Axe, the other guy that was kidnapped. Again, the group's not very heroic. Think about their own problems and issues. They're going into a situation they are completely outclassed for. And it'll be interesting, because this place also houses a bunch of other people. So we might have some other supers showing up. It's going to be a lot of fun. So then a big battle broke out with the police, and they did manage to not kill any police officers.
That's good.
For the first time.
Oh, that...
For the first time.
Yeah, never mind.
So, for the first time, they managed to escape police without actually killing anyone. So, it was an exciting episode. Hopefully you guys go check it out. Glushi had a really epic James Bond-esque moment where he slid a car and stepped out of it while it was still sliding and shot a guy in the head. That was pretty great.
That's pretty cool.
He rolled natural 20, man. That shit's got a...
It's pretty cool.
Epic. It was fun. It was a lot of fun. Hopefully you guys are liking Vanquished. It's so much fun to GM, and it's been really fun growing these characters with the players and talking to them afterwards about where their characters are headed and what kind of stuff they're looking forward to down the line. And it's been really neat, and I'm excited to... We're not even through volume one. We're still in like that first volume.
That's awesome.
Which is pretty rad.
Yeah.
I think you'll get to be there for the end of the volume if everything goes as planned, which it never does.
Oh, I got excited. I wanted to be there for the grand finale.
You probably will be for this volume.
Okay.
Most likely.
Good.
I think so.
I like that.
It's going to be fun. Okay, well, that's pretty much the rundown. And as you guys heard, Bronze Girl will be on the episode.
I'll be there. I'm everywhere now.
Everywhere.
Everywhere you look, I am there. In the bushes, outside your window.
Go take a dump right now and look up. She'll just be there. Under the covers, later night, open your eyes.
I'm going to be there, grudge style.
I'll fucking fight you. That would be the funniest thing in the world to wake up and you're just like touching noses with someone. I'll fucking fight you.
Fight you. I will put you in the ground. I think I said that too.
I'll put you in the ground. Actually, you did. You definitely
did
said I'll put
that.
You in the ground.
Yeah.
That must be like a recurring line that you've used.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You said I own a shovel. Numerous times.
Yeah.
I own a shovel.
Yep. Yeah.
Clever.
I am a cool, calm-headed young lady who never loses her cool.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Okay. So that's... What's that, Joe? Do you have something to say? Well, I guess we can get into some news.
Yes.
Actually.
Yes.
Some comic book news. Did you hear about this?
I did. I tweeted about it. It was... I don't know. I had like this whole... Okay. You go first and then I'll go so that I don't like fire off.
Cool. I hope we disagree. So, Faith number 5 is getting a special variant cover. It comes out right around the time of election. I think it's like a week or two before the election actually happens in November. And it's the election 2016 special where Faith is standing on the cover with Hillary Clinton. Will appear in the 5th issue of Faith of Value Comics. Oh, she'll appear in the issue. Holy shit.
Yeah.
I didn't even... I just thought it was the cover, but holy crap. Yeah, that's awesome. Now, what's interesting about this is there have been... How do we say? Like, Obama showed up in a Spider-Man book.
Yeah.
But not while he was running.
Yes.
It was after he was already president.
Mm-hmm.
So this is effectively Valiant taking a stand and being like, we support the Democratic Party in this instance. Which is a unique place for comic books to go.
Yeah.
That kind of stand. I'm okay with it.
I'm not.
See, I'm totally fine with it because it's like... In this instance, if you are a person of power in the industry or all that kind of stuff, for the most part, I say if you're an entertainment provider, it's not your place to talk about politics. Like, not your place.
Yeah.
You shouldn't talk about it. Like, you're here to entertain, all that kind of stuff. And then I watch the Republican National Convention and I say, dear God, I feel like it's my responsibility to do everything I possibly fucking can to not allow what's about to happen to happen.
But this was
and
before
I freak the fuck
RNC.
Out. I know, but that doesn't matter. Everybody's seen what's coming and we keep kind of turning a blind eye to it.
As true.
You know, and like, and there becomes a point where you're like, do I keep my mouth shut and be silent or do I take a stand and do what I think is right? So it's...
And I have to reserve a little bit of judgment until I actually read the comic book, which is why I was like, I'm going to take a moment and like just like process it. Because when I originally tweeted, I was upset about it. Because mm-hmm. I was like, it's one thing when comics broach these subjects in a comedic fashion like they did with Vote for Loki.
Yeah.
Like that comic did point out a lot of the ridiculousness of the Trump campaign and just like this general election. Like even Hillary's not, you know, clean as the whistle either,
no,
right?
No, of course not.
So it actually did. And the whole joke is like, there is no good candidate. Vote for Loki.
Right.
And even the whole like sort of ludicrousness of the election process, it pointed out that it's a popularity contest
this
point, right? It's not even, you know, the candidates and the issues they stand for and the platforms. It's literally just a big popularity contest. So that I thought it was kind of tongue in cheek and I thought it was cute and I really liked it. I hope this is comedic as well. Otherwise, I just don't feel like it has a place in comic books. As a variant cover,
I thought it was a variant cover.
But for Hillary Clinton to be in the comic, that's just kind of starting. I don't know if I want to go down that trail.
Mm-hmm. It says the issue has 3 stories in one. Louise Simonson is writing the Hillary appearance, which isn't even Jody Hauser, which is interesting because Jody is extremely, extremely meta. They said in their interview about this that they were trying to get people to vote, but that on the cover is going to lead folks, so I'm not sure. Yeah, I mean, what's interesting is, like, if it was Jody writing it, I'd have full confidence because she's so meta. And it would be, like, Hillary appearing in the issue in some super meta way, you mm-hmm, know, and, like, mm-hmm. in a very, like, as Faith, as a normal person would have to have her encounter with politics. Because that's how everything works in that book. It's, like, her as a normal person dealing with being a superhero and the internet and everything else. It definitely wouldn't be, like, her just being friends with Hillary. So that's interesting. But, you know, it's like you see people like, you know, like at the end of the day, like when Trump makes an appearance on Saturday Night Live, is that taking a stand? Is that supporting a candidate? Like, where is the line? Where do you draw the line?
Well, usually Saturday Night Live goes out of their way to invite both candidates.
Right.
And I think that that's important, too. So if they were trying to get people to come out and vote, I wish they had done the issue like that.
But that's the other thing. Yeah, like, how do you do it?
Faith runs for president. But that would have been kind of interesting.
Right. Yeah, getting people to go out and vote and all that kind of stuff. It's a tough one because I can see the arguments happen in my head with people. And, like, these... You know, like, I can just see, like, people, they're a very progressive company, Valiant, you know, for a comic book company especially. Not all comic book companies are, and they have good practices, and they have great diversity within their books, and Faith in Herself is a great representation of female empowerment. And in no way, shape, or form do I see Valiant ever saying, oh yeah, you can vote and vote for Trump. I wouldn't happen. So it is interesting that they took the route of you can vote and maybe you should vote for Hillary. Because like you said, it's like neither of them are squeaky clean. And then it's like you watch the
I kind of wish this would have come out like back when we were still trying to vote for the Democratic candidate. I feel like that would have been more poignant or whatever.
Yeah.
Like back when Bernie was running, because then they could have still been like staunch Democrats and encouraged people to vote and get involved in the electoral process without endorsing a specific candidate. I feel like that would have been better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting. It's the kind of stuff that honestly I do think about at night. Like, this is the kind of shit that keeps me up. It's like your responsibility as an entertainer, if there is one. Like, I used to be in a position where I thought, especially when we used to do Honesty Hour and stuff like that, I was like, you know what? I'm going to just be really open and honest and say whatever the hell you guys ask of me. Yeah. And then there came a point where I was like, wait, that's not really fair either, because there's power within that honesty, and there's power in saying this is how I think. And now, even though I could say, and whatever you think is totally fine and cool too, there's still that aspect of like, but I'm doing it from a soapbox.
Yeah.
And you're not. You're listening.
Yeah.
So it does take, like, there's this little bit of responsibility that's involved in
that. Oh,
there.
Yeah,
the
definitely.
Things that you say when you're on a platform.
Oh, yeah.
And taking that, like, okay, well, I'm an entertainer. At the end of the day, we're here to entertain you, not to take a political stance. Now, can I say in all honesty, I do not want to live in a world where Trump is actually the president of something? Yeah. Do I think he will be? No. I don't think it's going to happen. That's the only, like, hope I have.
I didn't think it was going to happen, and if I'm full disclosure, with everything that's going on in the world right now and all of the terrorist activity, I think it will happen, because if there's something that the American public has proved, it's that our votes are definitely motivated by fear.
Yeah. But that being said, is as batshit crazy as the Republican convention has been, there's also glimpses of hope. And, you know, it's like when you have a ton of Republicans basically saying, you know, no, this convention will not even start until we do a delegate recount because we are not okay with this man representing
our
party.
I wish we could do a vote of no confidence.
A vote of no confidence, yeah.
Literally just throw out both candidates and get fresh ones.
Right.
That would have been really cool.
A vote of no confidence.
They have it in other countries.
Interesting.
They don't have it here. And all you do is you basically, if enough people, you know, vote for the vote of no confidence or however it goes in the said country, they have to redo the whole elections, and the people who are currently the candidates can't run, because it just shows that people don't have faith in them. And what's sad is when you look at social media and even the chat here, most people are like, I don't like either one. We're going to vote for the lesser of two evils. That should not be how you choose your president. That is terrible.
But
I think this is important, though, because look at this right now. So this is a comic book show, and we're actually talking about this because of Faith. So you know what? I'm going to go back on what I said. It's going to start the discussion, and I think maybe that alone has value in it.
It does have value. And you know what?
Maybe at local comic book stores, people are going to see that, and maybe instead of talking about the new Nighthawk, they're going to talk to each other about politics.
That's a really good point, because you and I were just talking about Nighthawk a second ago, and this...
It is a political comic.
Right. And the thing is, we're taking a stand on Faith because it hit national news. There's a lot of comics coming out right now that are doing things that if the news found out about it, they'd write about
it. Oh, yeah.
But they don't read comics.
Yeah.
And that's what I also think is funny. The people who also complain about these things are also people that don't read comics. Like, all the people who are going to be offended by this Faith cover aren't the people who read Faith. Faith is a book about female empowerment. The people who are going to be upset about this cover don't read the book. Valiant's not losing customers. Mm-hmm. Now, they might lose Bloodshot supporters, but maybe not many. You know what I mean? Like, Faith has sold really well, and it's a book that's staying true to that. But, you know, talking about Nighthawk, for instance, like, that's a book about a black dude beating the shit out of cops and white supremacists. Like, not just cops in general, but, like, crooked cops and white supremacists. And no one's fucking heard about it.
While
nobody
wearing,
knows.
Like, Kanye's. He's wearing, like, Yeezys.
Yeah. Nobody's talking about it, and the book's fucking good.
He's awesome, too.
And it's a great book.
Nighthawk's a cool guy.
It's taking a very strong stance.
Against police brutality and racism.
Yeah.
And it's
very political.
It's like not soft about it. He is beating the crap out of people.
No, I think at the end of the second issue, he basically says, like, something along the lines of police brutality against black people. Like, it's just straight up. It's straight up. So it is, as a piece of art,
taking a stance.
And what's
crazy is it's a Marvel comic.
Right.
Right? So it's not like it is one of
Disney.
The two main comic houses that is taking, basically one of their comics is taking a hard stance against police brutality and against racism.
Yeah.
And so doesn't that mean the company is as well? Because
no. That's what I think. Because they're, and this is actually what gives me faith in the comic book industry, is you have to look at the creators as artists. Just as if you're a music house and you so Sony owns a ton of music providers, stuff like that.
Mean they,
and if a hip hop artist comes out and says something very specifically about their political beliefs or how they do certain things, or if a folk singer makes a very strong stance, whatever, that's not Sony saying this is our belief.
Fair enough, yeah.
And that's why I kind of like, if it's the creators themselves are like, this is what I want to do, and this is the story I want to tell, and the company supports that, I applaud the shit out of that, because that's ballsy. It's a strong statement, and it's kind of like it makes me have faith that comic books are actually art. If they were just, and it's funny that a lot of men rights activists complain and say that there's this giant political agenda to shove diversity down their throats. And it's funny to me, because it's like, if you actually worked in the industry, you'd understand that it's almost completely the fucking opposite. That you have to, like, work really, 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 really hard to get diversity in. Not
people think, they still, like, throw around numbers and say it won't sell.
Right.
And right, every company is for profit, right? So at the end of the day, it's like, well, if it's not selling, we have to pull it. But they never really give it the chance to begin with, which we were talking about when I said I'd fight you. I was saying that a lot of times, like, they'll give us these token characters and then they'll say, well, it didn't sell well. Like Batwing. I was talking about Batwing the other night on my
Pass the Water 78. You're banned. Get out. You can't say shit like that. Get out. Go somewhere else.
it was like we were talking about Batwing, and so many people were like, who's Batwing? And I was like, Lucius Fox had a son. Yeah. And that is Batwing. And he is actually a really cool character. And he totally deserves to see the spotlight as much as Batwoman or Batgirl. But he never sees the light of day. So many people just don't even know that Batwing exists. And that's kind of sad. But technically, there is a black character that is part of the Bat family.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just hate seeing these throwaway characters, because then they use that as an excuse. Like, well, we've tried that before and it doesn't sell.
But you're not putting them in the forefront.
So it's a lot harder. You're completely right. It's harder to push the diversity in.
It's really hard. It's why it's one of those things people say a lot when they're not actually in the industry as an outsider, because what they see is more of it and they're not used to seeing it, which is a good sign that things are changing. Just the fact that people are getting upset means things are changing, which is good. And those people being upset is kind of like, well, at least now they're seeing more of it finally and they're upset about it. But that's not it being shoved down your fucking throat. That's not some political, like, that's creators, artists who are working their asses off to fight for that right to happen. That doesn't mean that the art's by default good.
Mm-hmm.
It's still open to criticism. It's still open to judgment. Just because something is by default fought really hard for doesn't mean that it's just all of a sudden, oh, it's fucking great. Yay. Like, I wish it was, but it's not. It's definitely not. But
yeah, you're totally right about, like, with art, even controversial films, controversial paintings, they can still be garbage.
Totally. 100%. 100%. And sometimes they got famous only because of the controversy, which is not the right thing. Usually it starts with an artist saying, this is important to me, and they work really, 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 really hard to push it through. So I respect the fact that companies like Marvel are taking that chance with these books, because they're not saying as a company, Marvel is this. Marvel would never come out and have a stance per se and be like, we are for black, you know, the Black Panther kind of ideal that's rebooting up and everything in America right now. They won't do that. But if a creator comes to them and says, this is the book and the story I want to tell, and they support it, that makes me have confidence in Marvel as a company and say, like, you know, bravo. That's a ballsy move. You could get a lot of shit for it. Mm-hmm. But it makes me feel that comics are still art, because art should be able to do that. Art should be able to take a stance.
Should be protected, too.
And it should be able to take a stance the opposite direction, to be totally honest. Like, I would be very okay with seeing a book on the stands from the point of view of the other side. 100%. Because I think that's also important if it's art.
And I've taken
that
stance. If
it's not pandering and it's art.
I can't believe I forgot the artist's name. You've probably heard the whole controversy with the Spider-Woman cover.
Mm-hmm.
I was okay with it. I was like, he's famous for doing erotic art. He drew erotic Spider-Woman. Like, you can't... And people were like, wow, Bronze, you of all people. I'm like... Well, I get that her butt looks like an apple and that she's in this really seductive pose, but why would you hire an artist
right.
who is famous for doing erotic art,
right.
have him do this cover, and then throw him under the bus?
It's a management problem. To me, that's a management problem. It's like, it's your fault for hiring the erotic artist. Like, the erotic artist did his art. And, you know, Malika kind of had a very similar viewpoint. Like, what's the problem? Like,
yeah, I didn't have any issue with it.
It's like Mortal Kombat comes out and Melina and all the other characters still have boobs hanging out and everything else. But it's like, but I'm buying Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
This is a game where people smash their skulls.
It doesn't bother me. And for me, it's like, how can you sit here and say no slut shame me and slut shame video game characters?
Right. Yeah. So, it's a balance that apparently will always, as a culture, argue about.
I just
about.
Like to see a mix. It's nice to not have every single... It's nice to have characters like Faith
mm-hmm.
who don't look like your meta, like, you know, unrealistically tiny ways, gigantic
no, but
boobs
that, exactly,
size of her
but
head.
That having her exist doesn't mean that Wonder Woman can't exist.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. It should be a mix, and it's okay to have both.
Right. I completely agree, and that's weird. Because if you would have heard us talking 2 weeks ago, you would think Bronze Girl... Actually, she did tell me this. I'm afraid to be on a show with you because I think we would just argue nonstop and I'd hate you.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, that's great content. He's like, that's perfect. No, that's exactly what I want. I want to be able to argue with somebody. I want to argue. And this is a place where you guys should be able to have conversations in the chat room and stuff like that. But if you start name-calling and you start, like, belittling people for their beliefs... That's not okay. Even if someone believes something that you think is completely asinine, as long as that belief isn't hurtful to someone else, you have to listen to them. That's, to me, the bottom fucking line. And that's why this is a safe space. You know, and it's like, yesterday we had to get on to somebody because they were just sitting there calling Malika hot. And it's like, and he got mad that somebody told him that's not okay to do. And it's like, you're catcalling. And we're saying catcalling is not okay. You can either respect that or you can go somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And then other people in the chat room are saying, that's why I feel this is a safe place. And it's like, and I like that. And I like that we've built that community. But at the same time, if somebody comes in and says something that might be offensive to you, you have to understand that it's okay to have a different belief system as long as they're not insulting someone else. The second it becomes an insult or an attack, get the fuck out. You can argue with people without saying, I'll bury you and put you in the ground. I have a shovel. You can do that. It can happen.
Yeah, no, it can. I don't endorse that at all.
I guess the biggest thing there is don't go arguing on the internet with alcohol in your blood. Then you'll be fine.
Yep.
Yeah. Are there any famous characters with depression? There's been a couple. Some of them a little too heavy-handed. Actually, I feel like depression is probably one of the more commonly used, like, trope in some ways to make a character, and I don't think it's usually handled very well.
Mm-hmm. I would say some of our main characters are depressed. I think Bruce Wayne is depressed.
Oh, he's definitely. He is kind of like...
Clinically depressed.
Yeah, like textbook. Actually, I would say that's a good way of handling it because they don't make it a pandering kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't like it when it's like a character like Penis comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, oh yeah, Civil War really tore me up and now I'm going to trap myself inside this, speedball, changes his character 100% and turns into a dude who's inside a torture chamber that's stabbing him multiple times every time he moves, and it's like, are you fucking serious? Like that's like really heavy. Could he not just be a person who's having like a reaction to the horrible thing that's happened? Not.
And I like seeing sometimes when they work through it, because for people who are in a mirrored situation, it kind of might be helpful for them. Like, mm-hmm. I loved Death of the Family because Batgirl totally has PTSD in that. Like hardcore. She's in a closet in her underwear crying, like totally shut down. It's kind of cool to see her cope with it. But it's cool to see your superheroes as vulnerable people who might struggle with the same things you struggle with. It is cool.
I mean, that's the thing too that I can't stand when people complain about diversity in comics. Their complaint alone lets you know they're coming from a place of privilege. Mm-hmm. The fact that you can even complain that Miles Morales is half Hispanic and half black should allow you to step outside yourself and realize, wait, why does that offend me?
Yeah.
Because every other fucking character is white in that universe. Like, you have to understand, yes, if we were in this world where, I guess the big thing is you never had to think about it. And that's something I had to realize a long time ago as a young white boy. Is like, I didn't have to think about it.
Yeah.
I got to just love Peter Parker and see myself in him.
Mm-hmm.
And in a perfect world, a young black boy or a young Hispanic boy in that situation would be able to just say, color and race doesn't matter. I identify 100% with Peter Parker. And a lot of young boys do. But unfortunately, the world steps in. And when the world steps in and starts saying, you're black, you're brown, and starts giving those labels, then they start re-looking at it and saying, well, Peter Parker's not like that. And and apparently Peter Parker represents this group of people.
Yeah.
It's not the kids that make that distinction. It's the world that does. And if that's the world we currently live in, then it's important that those individuals feel like they have the exact same opportunity to feel the same things I got to feel when I was a kid.
Yeah. And it's nice
holy
to
shit,
be able
this is awesome.
To relate on a cultural level. I always say, like, Miss Marvel is the comic I wish 100%. I had growing
that's
up.
That's the fucking Peter Parker of our generation.
I needed that comic growing up. Like, having to explain, like, when I was a teenager, like, I can't date. Oh, my God. Every person was like, what do you mean you can't date? It's like, no, I'm Indian. I'm supposed to have an arranged marriage. I'm not allowed to date boys. I don't date. And it's so cool to watch Kamala go through that same stuff when her parents bring that boy home. Like, oh, hey,
yeah,
I hook
and
you up with
and
him.
At the same time, having to deal with superhero problems like every other superhero.
Yeah.
And it creates an even
and
playing
it
field.
It makes you feel like, I can deal with this. Kamala can deal with this. We're going to deal with it together. Here's the superhero I can relate with, you know?
Right. And the difference is a young white boy or girl is not going to read that book and think it's weird. Because for one, they're not being told they're different. They're just told they're just them. They're just being them. So they can relate. Whereas someone who's being told their whole life they're different is going to read something else and feel like this doesn't represent them. You know, so I think it's important to have those differences because young people then get to be like, you know, and whatever. That's kind of a political statement in itself and an ideology kind of difference. But if people complain, it's already coming from a place of privilege. It's like you have the ability to complain about the fact that a character is now another color than yourself. Like, that's a very privileged argument in and of itself, especially when the other characters are still around.
Yeah. Yep.
That's when it's really kind of like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, get over yourself. Nobody took your childhood away. It's fine. It's fine. The only time it ever makes me upset is when the book isn't good.
Yeah.
You know, like when that happens, whenever the book's bad.
I really didn't like the ghostwriter.
Oh, you didn't like Robbie?
I didn't.
I fucking loved it.
Really?
I loved Robbie Thompson.
I thought it was...
Or not Robbie Thompson. Sorry, Robbie is the character. Robbie Thompson's a writer. Robbie, I thought, was an awesome character. I loved it so much. I liked him and his little brother.
Yeah, I liked the character, but the setting for the book itself, like when he's taking out the Chola demons and stuff.
Yeah, like, okay,
With the lowrider. What happened with that comic? I mean, people were like, oh, Mexican ghostwriter and a lowrider. Oh,
yeah.
And it was like, oh, like, he's actually a cool character, and I loved his crossover with Kamala. And I was like, why didn't... You needed to, like, I don't know, ease people into that, you know, or something, because... It was a little, it just felt really stereotypical.
And see, well, that's
weird.
One of those things that I would have been, it's all about that, like, perception of where it comes from. And it was a Hispanic team that was doing it, an Hispanic artist, and they were like, this is great.
Yeah.
This is awesome.
Yeah.
Because they're two Hispanic dudes that lived in LA.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the artist come on my last comic book show, and he's a really cool guy.
Yeah.
He actually came wearing weird horns and he's a really cool dude. And, like, that was the world he loved drawing and knew. So it's that kind of like, fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when you're from that world and you draw it, is it still a misrepresentation or like a stereotypical representation?
I think he has every right to, but I think that on the outside, like from what other people are seeing. They don't know that. They don't have that perspective, and it feels weird. I'm not saying the man, okay, when I say the comic felt racist, that's not me saying the artist was racist.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's me saying
the premise
could have. It felt weird. I didn't know, like, I had no context.
Right.
I was like, okay, you guys, oh, look, that's awesome. We've got Miles Morales in the spider suit. We got Kamala Khan as Miss Marvel. And look, we got this new brown character as Ghost Rider. That's super cool. And then I opened the comic. I was like, he drives a lowrider and he kills Chola demons. That's strange. Because coming from Miles Morales and Miss Marvel, I was like, she's not fighting, like, Dijins and stuff,
no, she's not.
Like, she's fighting the normal characters, so it felt weird.
The difference they tried to make in that was the demon itself had possessed this drug lord in the community, and that's where it was coming from. Eli or whatever, and his other demon or something like that. I kind of wanted him to stick around because I thought he was a cool character.
Yeah.
I really liked the relationship he had with his little brother, and I thought that was an interesting take that we hadn't seen yet.
Mm-hmm.
Was like, this is literally a teenager kid having to take care of his disabled little brother. And I was like, oh, I haven't really seen that before. Like, it's an interesting take with different problems than I'm used to. But I could see immediately how it's like, oh, yep, but he does drive a lowrider, and there are definitely a lot of gang members, and the whole thing was actually about
gang members. I grew up in California, and I just didn't want to see them represented that way, because I feel like that's a stereotype.
Right, and it's only perpetuating it.
Mm-hmm.
I could see that and completely agree. So, oh, Galzathron, thank you so much for that follow. This all came out of us talking about whether or not Hillary Clinton should be on the cover of Faye. And I think we're both okay with it. I'm especially okay with it if it was a decision by the creators of the book, as in the artists and the writers. If it was some corporate kind of top-down kind of thing, I'd be a little weirded out by it. So, that's the end of it.
Moving on.
Yeah. Chat room's just, you know, they're having a
whole lot of time. I'm like, I'm trying to catch up. I think that's why we're okay with Faith. It started the conversation.
Now, Parvis, I don't think it's fair to say, okay, so a lot of them are walking stereotypes. A lot of them aren't. That was a specific instance of a walking stereotype from her perception. And I think that Miles Morales is not a stereotype.
No, not at all.
He's a character. Kamala Khan is not a stereotype. She's a full, rounded, very interesting character with her own wants and wishes and thoughts and beliefs that differ from her culture and everything else. And that's what makes her so interesting, is she's not just someone from this culture. She's someone who's like, well, what do I want to stick with?
Yeah,
like, what
she's
do
not
I want
to puppet?
Yeah. What do I want to believe in? I get to choose. And that's what makes her interesting. And then even with Nighthawk, like, we don't know too much about the character yet, but there's nothing stereotypical about that book. That's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
It's fucking good. It's super badass.
Yeah, no, it is.
It's
entertaining.
Really good. It's really entertaining. So that all came out of that. We're probably going to have to just show this trailer and then talk about our picks of the week.
Here's a question. Can a character drive a lowrider, be a Chola, and be okay in your eyes? I've actually watched the Cholas try videos on YouTube where they do things like eat sushi and stuff. I'm not saying they're bad people. Mm. I just don't want... How should I say this? I don't want white people to read that book and have an laugh at the expense of brown people. That's what I was trying to say. That's all.
No.
I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that culture. I'm just saying that...
It's an outsider looking in perspective.
Yes.
If the first instance someone in Japan has of Americans is just... Okay, well, we're going to make them white Americans. We better put them in cowboy hats and say President Bush and Texas.
Mm-hmm.
You would be kind of like, well, that's not, you know, there's a lot more to it than that. Mm-hmm. We're not like that. That's one facet, you know. So I think that's the point that's trying to be made, is just there's a lot more there. So why in your first storyline would you just present that? It didn't seem thought out, well thought out. All right, so this is a new show coming out from Stan Lee, and we have a trailer for it here, a new cartoon that comic book resources saying the most Stan Lee of Stan Lee things. Pretty preload. We're going to let that preload a little bit. Preload. It's also in the context of the previous Ghost Rider. Did the previous character do those things? Well, that was kind of the, one of the big differential things about that book is it's not... It's Ghost Rider in name alone. It's not even the same demon. Mm-hmm. It's a totally different story. It's a completely different story. It's a different demon named Eli who is actually an enemy of the Ghost Rider. And I thought that was one of the most interesting parts as well is like Ghost Rider is supposed to be the spirit of vengeance. And
yeah.
In this book, Robbie gets taken over by a fucking murderous psycho.
Yep. Uh-huh.
And he's having to battle internally against that murderous psycho to do the right thing instead of just murdering everyone that's wronged this demon. So that was actually pretty cool, I thought. So he didn't have to be like the spirit of vengeance. He didn't have that going against him. Is this going to work now? It's loading really slow. Let's try it.
No interviews, Melissa. The creative juices are overflowing. Writing always comes first.
They said something about having you on the cover.
I doubt he can even fucking write anymore.
Stan Lee, superhero writer and all-around great guy.
Stan, is what we're hearing about this new superhero team true?
Oh, you mean the badass brigade? Naturally, I made it up.
Ooh, but it might hurt your licensing opportunities, right?
I hate it.
Yeah, anyway, how did you come up with the idea?
Ironically, this incredible tale of titans and tumult, it started with a case of writer's block. Hard to imagine the idol of millions struggling for something to write, right? Well, contrary to what you may have heard, I am human. But don't let that get around. But this time, it was like the idea for my latest and greatest group of heroes just fell out of the sky. I didn't know it was a spaceship until I got close to it. I could hear someone or something inside. Seven aliens stepped out. They were sent into exile because they were troublemakers on their home planet, and now we'd be stuck with them. Silver Skylark, Strongarm, Laser Lord, Lady Lightning, Micro, Kid Kinergy, Roller Man. We heard helicopters coming, whether it was the Army or Oil Max or Fox News. I've written enough stories to know how that always turns out. So I got the aliens out, realizing it was now my responsibility to protect them, nurture them, and of course, figure out how to cash in on them.
Mr. Lee, are you standing on your desk by any chance?
No.
So let me get this straight. You're saying the Badass Brigade are real?
Yep.
And you're not just writing their adventures, you're training them to be actual heroes?
I'm also representing them in all their business endeavors. Give this article a good spin, kid, and I'll get you an autographed photo.
You forgot to ask us our opinions on all of this. We appreciate the shelter you have offered us, spindly human, but we have a whole planet to plunder. What do we need you for?
Let me call you back. Why is he naked?
I am as I was born.
Yeah, I called you the Badass Brigade, not the Bare-Ass Brigade. But then again, nah, that's too tacky. The new name needs a little pizzazz. Well, when in doubt, always alliterate. Melissa, get that reporter back on the phone. Next on Stan Lee's Cosmic Crusaders, the team gets costumes, plus we ponder Strongarm's peculiar proclivities. Till next time, this is Stan Lee saying, Excelsior!
Keep an eye out for the fully animated Stan Lee's Cosmic Crusaders. Coming soon, Stan Lee's Cosmic Crusaders merchandise, only at Hot Topic and HotTopic.com.
That's the kicker right there. That's the fucking kicker.
Oh, that was a poor taste.
Yeah, so this is 100% not even close to a Stan Lee idea. There's no way. There was a writer attached to it, definitely not Stan Lee. I mean, the whole thing is obviously supposed to be like a joke on, it's satire, but it's poorly presented satire.
Yeah.
And cringy satire. But
yep.
Anyway, Saint said sellout. Duh, he's like Stan Lee. That dude's fucking rolling in it. And I wouldn't doubt if the entire idea originated out of a brand deal with Hot Topic in the first place.
I've been waiting.
Did it. You finally did it. Congratulations. Guys, round of applause for that bronze girl getting that sneeze out now an hour into the program. Cool. Well, we watched that thing. Let's talk about
that
comic books.
That was a thing.
That was a fucking thing. Once again, guys, our comic books are provided by Alter Ego Comics, located at Crossroads Mall here in Bellevue. Pretty cool place. You should check them out. If you go to sublist.alterego.com, I believe, or one of those variations of that address, sublist.alteregocollectibles.com, my bad, you can see this nice little handy list of books that have come out today, and they are ranked in order of most purchased from this location, which is always interesting. Always interesting, because as we've learned, Microsoft employees really like My Little Pony.
Yeah.
And
yep.
Like no other store I've seen, because I went to comic book stores in LA, My Little Pony did not sell that well there. It sells really well here, and it's number 3 on today's pickups.
Yeah, yep, yep.
But we don't have too much time, so I wanted to talk about the books we did read and what we thought about them and all that good stuff. So why don't you go first?
I love Darth Vader, number 23.
You did?
Yes.
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to read it.
This story arc in general is super awesome. So basically, he's battling this evil scientist, Silo. And he has these two super cool droids that work under him. And one's called Double Zero. It's Double Zero, Zero, Triple Zero. And the other one's called BT. And it's really cool seeing evil droids. Because, like, one of them is, like, the C-3PO style
bot. So you haven't been reading all the Darth Vaders leading up to this?
No, I have.
Oh, okay, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but it's so cool to see his interactions with, like, especially in this comic, I was just giggling profusely because I was like, he's such an evil little metal bucket. I love it. And
pretty good.
Yeah, this comic has a super crazy plot twist at the end, so I can't spoil it. But it did upset me a little bit because it was one of those, like, you know those moments where it's like, if you could do that all along, why didn't you do it all along? You know how when comic books do that, when you're like, if you could do that earlier, why didn't you do it earlier?
Well, that's kind of like Superhero 101. Like, I mean, that's how the Valiant role-playing game is built. There's plot points because it's like a character is as strong as you need them to be in any given moment to move the story forward. And it's true. There are no limits.
Yeah. And so that bothered me in Pacific Rim where it's like, you know, all the stuff's going on at the end. They're like, there's one more option. We have a giant sword we haven't used in the entire rest of the movie. So at the end of the Darth Vader comic, I'm not going to spoil it for you. It's a pretty big plot twist, but there's something happens and you're just kind of like, why didn't he do that earlier?
Yeah.
But it's cool though. I'm not going to argue about that. My money's on next comic, Darth Vader's going to heel turn. We're going to see heel turn Darth Vader.
Interesting.
He's going to go off the rails.
Star Wars number 21, number one seller this week, coming out from Jason Aaron, was really fucking good. And any cover by David Aja makes me pick it up.
It's beautiful.
I'm like, fuck
it's
yeah.
Beautiful.
His cover work is so good, and it just makes me immediately miss all of Hawkeye, but whatever. This is really good. The Creel is back with the all-new squad of stormtroopers, and these stormtroopers are fucking rad. This is a rad stormtrooper book. This is just straight up like little kid like, yes! Awesome! Oh, yeah, he threw the thing in the tank and he did the thun. And then a stormtrooper picks up a lightsaber at the end and it's so good! It's like, Jason Aaron gets Star Wars fans. He gets Star Wars fans. You can tell, like, when they asked him to write this book, he was like, oh, yeah, I got this.
Yeah.
Everything he does is just, like, Star Wars fan wet dream 101. He gets it. He gets it. There's so many cool shots of the stormtroopers walking out of the ship, and you see all their new costumes. You're like, ooh, how are those different?
Even the cover, like the way they're lined up. Oh, no, they're cool.
It's fucking great. And then you're like, I'm a stormtrooper because of this and this. And it's actually a really interesting perspective. This whole book takes place from the perspective of the stormtrooper. He's talking about the Empire saved his life.
Yeah. Yep.
Because he's like, when he was a kid and he was growing up on this planet and he was like a part of these like slave games and stuff. And the Empire came in and saved him. And it was the stormtroopers that raided this compound and saved him. And he sought his entire life to be a stormtrooper and to fight the terrorists and the evil. And it's like all that stuff. We were just like, oh man, Star Wars sometimes can be really great.
I love this comic because it's cool to see stormtroopers with some kind of personality. Because so often it's just like you know, and they're just drunk. They're like bumbling around, and they're usually portrayed almost like it's kind of idiots. Like they're easy to fool. They have stormtrooper aim is like a thing, right? Like, oh yeah, stormtroopers can't shoot straight. So it's cool to see them be badass. Like
they're competent as fuck.
Yeah,
they're like a straight up hit squad.
And on some level, you know that they are competent because look at how successful
they took
Empire
over the galaxy.
Is. Clearly, they're competent, but we never get to see them be competent. And in our defense, it's because we're seeing it from the point of view of the protagonists, of the heroes. So it's cool to see, like, they get ish done. And this is going to be awesome right before, you know, Rogue One comes out, because that movie's going to be dark as all hell. And it's going to be cool. Like, we're going to see this type of stormtrooper.
I don't know. We'll see. I'm worried.
Really?
Well, they've already, like, talked about... I mean, didn't they just like bring in a new director?
Oh, and they said they were gonna like re-edit,
reshoot,
stuff.
And re. Yeah. Yeah, that's always when that.
Why
happens.
Why do they think it's too dark? Did it not go well with the
focus
group?
Mean, probably. Well, I don't know. I really like that director's early work. But the last movie he did was Godzilla, which was flat as a fucking pancake.
Yeah.
Like that was the emotional resonance of a doorknob. It was meh all the way through. So I don't know.
I can agree with that.
Yeah, but
pacing was not very good.
Anyway, let's see. What? So you read that too?
So good. It's so beautiful too.
I'm still reading Ultimates and fucking loving it. Ultimates number 9 was really great. I'm a big fan of the Ultimates books. And there was something really great in this book that happened. Like, there's all this setup and you think that they're going to take down this giant monster and everything. And then they reach out a hand and help him and pull him in. Like, it was the most interesting take on Ulysses' power yet. And they're like, and he's like, I thought, what's happening? And they were like, thanks to you letting us know he was going to arrive at this time. If you hadn't told us, and we would have been reacting in a way that was out of fear and knee-jerk reaction, we would have most likely harmed this individual. Mm-hmm. But your warning gave us time to study and to understand, and that gives us the opportunity to help.
Yeah.
And it was a really cool thing, because you don't see that in these kinds of books that often, and the Ultimates already as a team are taking a really interesting stand in the Marvel Universe. So I was, the art shifted, it shifted artists twice though, and that kind of weirded me out, always does, but whatever. What's your next one?
This week I read A-Force. I actually really like this book.
Yeah?
I didn't think I was going to.
I like A-Force.
I like it. It's really good.
Robbie Thompson writes it. And he's a good dude.
In this one, my takeaway was I love the conversations they have with each other.
Mm-hmm.
It's so hard to get a team of superheroes together who have chemistry. These girls have chemistry. I love Nico. I love all of them. I never got like really invested in Lady Thor, or I did. I was always invested in She-Hulk. I love She-Hulk. She's my bae. But I never really got super attached to even Medusa or any of these characters. But you know, after reading so much of A-Force, and we're 7 issues into the 2016 version, I really like it. Mm-hmm. And you know what my takeaway from this comic was? First of all, I love the art. And second of all, just read it for the conversations. Listening to them talk to each other, and like their little jabs at each other, and I feel like I know them as people. Like,
well, Robbie Thompson he's a dialogue writer. He wrote for Supernatural, the TV show, and that's kind of like his thing. He writes that like dialogue,
well,
quippy and stuff
it.
Like that. And he did Silk when Silk first came out, which was really good.
It was good. I feel like it's kind of but it was originally very good, and it's weird to kind of. I always kind of thought Medusa was a bitch. And now I'm like, no, she's awesome. There's facets to her personality I don't think I really knew about before.
Well, there you go.
I feel like I know
I like
her
A-Force.
Now.
It's great.
I feel like she's my friend and we go get margaritas together. That's what I feel like.
You're like, that's my queen.
Mm-hmm.
So my pick of the week, because we're not going to have too much time to talk about too many books, is Faith number 1. I wanted to say really quickly, check out Snot Girl. It's Brian Lee O'Malley's new book. And
I didn't read that one. What's that about?
It's a fashion blogger in Los Angeles who is fake as fuck, and she's constantly she's super thin, she has no friends, and they make that very clear. And she has this life she lives online, but in reality, she has really, really bad allergies, and she's always has snot running out of her nose, and she's always crying, and like her allergies are so bad. Mm-hmm. And so she never like goes out into the real world. So the real world her is like non-existent. And she says that the real her is her online personality that she puts out as a fashion blogger, which is very fake and very thin. And she has no friends and everything. And then she meets a girl that she thinks is going to be her friend. But the second that girl like looked at her the wrong way, she kills her. So the book's going to be interesting, but it's like it's really vapid and it's really hard to read at times because because it's so accurate at portraying it that I'm like, oh, I want to burn this book. Like, I hate these kind of people. I hate them so much. Yeah. But it is really interesting and it is a really good read. Now, Faith Number One came out today. Jodi Hauser's now ongoing run, and I fucking loved it. Mm-hmm. It was so good. Mm-hmm. I really like Faith. I'm a big fan of Jodi, and again, like, she does meta so well.
Yeah.
And she understands superheroes. Emily, you have my book. Where's my book? I gave it to Emily to read, and I didn't get it back. Emily, give me my book. I wanted to read the first page out of that book. Emily! Emily! Emily, give me my book! Emily! Emily! Give me that book! I can hear it echoing in the other room. I know you can hear me.
I imagine Emily running around there trying to find it.
Okay, so I want to just read you this first like two pages because it's just, like, to me, this like shows how I think this is a book for people who love comic books. Mm-hmm. Like, it's so meta. It's really great. A lot of origin stories start with a child being orphaned at a tragically young age. But losing my parents wasn't what made me Faith Herbert into a hero. They didn't leave me with billions of dollars or a list of names, no lightsaber or letters to Hogwarts for me. But they did leave me the stories they loved, stories that showed me how people could make the world a better place. And it shows her on the ground reading a bunch of comic books. And then I met a guy named Peter Stanchek, and he also helped me discover I had superpowers. Crazy, right? It turns out I'm what's called a psiot. That's a whole thing. I can fly and carry other people or objects in my companion field. The cake is a lie. I took the superhero name Zephyr. Cool, right? I was part of the amazing Psyout superhero team. We called ourselves the Renegades. We saved the world, but it wasn't easy. We lost friends along the way. When sometimes things don't go the way you expect, you don't think the happy ending teams will fall apart. Sometimes relationships do too. And sometimes it takes some trial and error to figure out where you belong. That shows like a little image of her fighting with Unity whenever they killed a bunch of people and she's like, fuck that, I'm out. For right now, that seems to be sunny Los Angeles. Most recently, I saved the city from a revenge-seeking alien celebrity death cult. They were kind of jerks. I even had a first date with a guy I like, and then we had an actual date with slightly less punching. But for now, I'm living life as Summer Smith, wild-mannered content writer for website Zipline. It would have been my dream job if I hadn't got superpowers. Now it's a way to hide in plain sight. Balancing between both a normal geek and a superhero isn't easy, but I'm ready for whatever comes my way. And then it goes on and she keeps talking and talking, and it shows her playing D&D with a group of friends, which I know Jodi does quite frequently. And what I was telling Emily before, or when I handed it to her, is like, I feel like this is a great book for geeks and for women in that none of it's pandering.
Yeah.
It's just straight up how it is. Mm-hmm. And what I hate about a lot of stuff that tries to pander to that audience is like stuff like Big Bang Theory or something like that, where it feels like it's sideways. It's not hitting it down. It's for the people who go, oh, I know somebody like that. That's totally like my friend.
Yeah.
That's like this or like that. This is like, no, yes, they might be playing an RPG and there's monsters and stuff like that, but it's from real character kind of moments, and they're talking about certain actions and how you maybe should have done this or done that, and you don't want to go into things head on alone, and using it as an allegory to her as a teammate and all that good stuff. And it's really well done, and it's not just pandering to geeks. It feels really original and unique, and the whole book feels like that. She's a geek. She's a real person who has real feelings about her appearance and her place in the world, and it never feels like it's coming from this place of like, don't you, we understand you. It doesn't do that. It's really great. So hats off to Jodi. This is a great first issue.
Like Supergirl? We know what women want. That's what Supergirl was, the show.
Yeah.
The TV show.
Yes. I tried watching one episode and I was like, are you fucking kidding me?
Like, listen up, Bronze. We know what girls like you want. I'm like, no, you don't.
Smokes a
you
fat really- cigar. We hired a couple female writers. This shit's in the bag.
No. That's probably it.
Bitches are going to love this. I feel like that was said at some point.
Yeah. All the bitches are going to like this show.
We put a fucking superhero in a costume. She's going to beat up men. They're going to love it. And then we'll give her a love interest. Fucking great.
But get this. She has a job at a fashion magazine. Bitches love fashion.
Bitches love fashion. We'll give her a black friend, too. Everybody loves that. We hit our diversity quota.
So spot on.
Yeah, this isn't how you hold a cigar. Well, obviously, I'm not a cigar smoker. I'm like,
bitches love fashion.
We have an interview to do. So we ran a little long because we talked so much shit earlier. Let's pull up this Skype interview. So let's see. Oh. Yes, go ahead and play that trailer, Joe, if you don't mind.
Hello, everyone. I'm Gregory Wilson, author of the novel Icarus, and along with artist Matt Slay, graphic and game designer Chris Suda, and the fine folks over at Silence in the Library Publishing, I'm bringing you Icarus the graphic novel via Kickstarter. We launched the Kickstarter about 2 weeks ago now, and so far the response has been, frankly, nothing short of incredible. We hit funding in a week, and since that time have charged past our first stretch goal and are closing in rapidly on the second stretch goal, which is an illustrated short story written by Maxwell Alexander Drake and illustrated by veteran fantasy artist Cyril Vanderhagen. So if you were a backer of this initial project, let me start by saying thank you. You are helping turn this dream into a reality, and I could not be more grateful to all of you for that opportunity. Please tell your friends and family and people you know about this, because the more people that we can get on board, the better the project is going to be. And that's really what I want to focus on for those of you who may not have backed this project yet, maybe those of you who are just tuning in and looking at this video for the first time. Icarus is a story of two outsiders, told from their perspectives. One of them is Icarus, a 6-foot-tall, fair-skinned boy with wings, significant powers, and no memory of anything but his name, who falls into the heart of a dormant volcano called Vol by the people who live there, and meets the other character, Jelinek, a 4-foot-tall, red-skinned, flame petal prospector, who has a 2-tailed, lava-resistant creature called a Solar for a companion, and a bad attitude. Both of them together have to fight against the Magisters, which is a race of beings that have enslaved Jelinek's world, and in the process of doing so, we'll find that even though they thought they were as different from each other as they could possibly be, they are in fact much closer to each other than they could conceivably have imagined. It's a story which really seems to have resonated with a lot of people, for which I'm very grateful. And one of the great things about this project is that the more people that we can get on board, the bigger and better the project is going to be. So beyond the story that I've already talked about with Maxwell Alexander Drake, future stretch goals include stories from best-selling author Michael Stackpole, from authors like Gail Martin, Aaron Rosenberg, Jane Raby, even Ed Greenwood, who of course is famous for having designed the Forgotten Realms universe in Dungeons & Dragons, and for each of them, they will have their own assigned artists, bringing a new take to the Icarus universe in each case. We also, as a later stretch goal, have the opportunity to produce a hardcover version of Icarus, which I'm pretty excited about, and even down the line, the possibility of producing a full 3D role-playing game for the computer, designed ably by Chris Suda and his amazing team. If any of this sounds cool to you, and I think you will find it pretty cool, take a look at those pledge levels that you'll see on the right of your screen and see what it is you'd be interested in backing. Then, please like us on Facebook, please retweet us on Twitter, and please let everybody know for your support of a project that I'm very proud of and I think is going to be amazing in the end run. We've done really, really well so far, and we've got over half of this Kickstarter left to go, and to really get this where we want it to be, we need everyone's help to make that happen. We're really excited about showing you everything that's going to happen next in the Icarus universe, and we can't wait for all of you to be on board. Thank you so much for backing, thank you so much for your interest, and please let's keep the momentum going on this incredible adventure together. Thanks.
Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back. We are here with Greg Wilson, the creator of Icarus, and that Kickstarter video that you guys just checked out. Welcome, Greg.
Hi. Hi, Zach. Hi, Bronze Girl. Hey, everybody.
Hey.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for using a good webcam and mic.
Well, I do. I stream on Twitch myself, so yeah, they all told me, like, the C920 and microphone, so I wanted to get something nice.
Yeah, the mic is great. Like, you are the only comic book creator I've ever Skyped in who had anywhere close to a decent setup, and that's great. It makes me happy.
I appreciate that. We did an interview once on a podcast I do with a guy who was in Scotland, and I swear to God, the guy was doing the interview from his bathroom. So, and I'm not making it heard flushing every half, like about every 10 minutes, there was just a flush nows in the background. And I'm like, what the? And it, finally, he's just like, excuse me. And then the door closes. So he had left the bathroom for the rest of the interview. So I had just like tremors still, like, you know.
Okay, so why don't you tell us about Icarus? If you were to give us like a really quick rundown on what Icarus is and what it means to you, that would be awesome.
Cool. Well, Icarus is originally started as a full novel, actually, and then it was converted into a graphic novel later on as part of a series. And it's about a young man with wings who falls into the heart of a dormant volcano on another planet. And the creatures that he meets there. Two in particular, Jelinek, who's a short, dark red-skinned flame petal prospector. It's like a source of energy for the area that he's in. Kind of like an Old West type, I guess. And his Solar, which is basically a big two-tailed lava-resistant dog, more or less. And those three creatures end up going through the volcano. Icarus remembers only his name and nothing about why he's there, but he has tremendous power. He wants to figure out what that power is, and he and Jelinek and Rig basically go through to discover his own mystery, what he's doing there, why he seems familiar to some people down there. He thinks he's never been there before, and also keep alive at the same time. So it released officially back in April, and has come out now in paperback, in digital versions, and also in an audio version, an audio dramatization, with Trendane, who I know is on chat and hangs out quite a bit with you folks at Hyper RPG. Trendane did one of the voices. George Ledoux, who's a well-known voice actor for game stuff, did the other. So
which voice did Trendane do?
Trendane did the voice of Icarus, and he did the voice of pretty much every monster.
So, oh, cool.
Salamander Kings, the Drake. He just lowered his voice like a step every time. At the end, he was like, I'm fine, I can handle it. So yeah. Anyway, it was
awesome.
Fun.
Well, that's really cool. So apparently Icarus was first a novel, correct? And then it became a graphic novel. What well, what inspired Icarus originally? What inspired you to shift that from novel to graphic form?
What inspired Icarus originally actually is Cirque du Soleil. I'm an unabashed Cirque du Soleil fanboy, like the whole nine yards. Like, it's way overpriced and I shouldn't do it, but I have the water bottle, like everything. I love Cirque du Soleil. So they had a production called Varakai, which is basically Icarus falls from the sky and that's it. And then everything goes in a different direction. But when I saw it, I had just had my first novel published, which was an epic fantasy, and I wanted to do something very, very different. And I saw that and I was just kind of like, that is amazing. Something about the visual really grabbed me. And so my poor wife basically drove home while I'm like frantically scribbling notes about, you know, like the mill looks like this and what would the creatures be? And so that's how the novel got started. And I finished the novel right before my daughter was born and every other bit of work ceased for a little while. And then I ran into Ron Garner from Silence in the Library Publishing at a convention. Who had done mostly anthologies and things like that. They actually did the biggest short story collection in the history of Kickstarter, which was called Athena's Daughters. It was about a collection that was all done about and for and by women, edited by women, written by women, and so on. Boing Boing picked it up and so on. So that was kind of where they first made their bones, but they wanted to get into graphic novel stuff. And I had ended up working with the artist, the first artist that they had assigned to do some of my short stories that I had done with them. And I really liked him. And that's how the whole thing kind of got underway from there.
Nice. Nice. Do you have any questions for him? You want to throw him some?
Okay. So one thing that I really liked when I was reading it was I liked the kind of creatures you created. They almost, what are your, how do I pose this? What are your, like, I guess, fantasy inspirations? Is it like Hellboy or Constantine? Like, what inspired you to create these interesting characters?
Those are some really good examples. Yeah, Hellboy for sure on the creature level. I kind of grew up as a big epic fantasy guy. So I was a big Tolkien and Lord of the Rings fan and that sort of thing. But I was always kind of interested in certain aspects of the monstrous. Like, I'm a college professor also, so I do a lot of my focus on sort of literary stuff first. So the tale of Beowulf and Grendel and the monster Grendel specifically always grabbed me. There's a book by John Gardner called Grendel, which is amazing.
Grendel's great.
Yeah, isn't it? And they're the incredible woodcuts that are part of Grendel, which I don't even know how to describe it. I don't have books. It was active, then they got novels in general, all before they were calling that, you know. would be amazing. And that stuff sort of stood with me about what the monstrous looks like to a legistress. And, you know, obviously it's monstrous to them, but to the other creatures, it would be the reverse. So I was really interested in that artistically and kind of looking at that. I am not an artist and I'm totally incapable of representing anything in art. It's just that I always in my mind had some of those things visually. But definitely, though, Hellboy for sure. Also Spawn a little bit, at least sort of the hell portions of Spawn a little bit. And then kind of conveying that and asking the artists, Mark Dos Santos, to be able to do the rest as I worked with them, which they were able to do. Like I was very, very happy with their kind of visions of the book eventually.
Sweet, thank you. And sorry guys about Skype. It does that stuff sometimes. It's Skype. Skype has hiccups.
Skype being Skype. No, Skype is amazing and never has any problems ever.
Yeah, never. Never at all. Definitely never just drops out ever. At all.
Yeah.
So what made you choose to go through Kickstarter to fund Icarus and to get it out into the world?
So when Icarus, when I first finished writing Icarus, I originally thought about it as like a prose novel. And my first novel was called The Third Sign. And when it got bought, sort of leading up to it getting bought, a lot of people said, the book is great, but it's epic fantasy, and epic fantasy has been, quotes, oversold. So we've seen this sort of thing before. And then eventually did sell, but I traumatized me. So I'm like, all right, I'm going to write something so different. I'm going to put him in the heart of a volcano with a guy who harvests flame petals, and his dog has got eyes that go diagonally, and market that, you know, and they couldn't market it at all. And so what I discovered was that it didn't sort of fit, I guess, conventionally. So Silence and Library Publishing has done all of their books initially through Kickstarter, and I knew already that I had an existing fan base because I had been, you know, going on Twitch for a while. I had my reader base and then on. So I was like, all right, you know, let's give it a shot. And it actually went really well. We ended up funding at about $16,000, which was twice goal. About 401 backers did that.
Nice.
And that gave us, of which a lot, I should say, came from Twitch to begin with. Twitch was really a big boost for that. And it just, I don't know, it was a way to kind of people invested early on. I felt better about it, especially because it was coming in a graphic novel slash comic side of things, where I feel like there's just more of an indie vibe, you know, to comic books and graphic novels than more sort of traditional, you know, straight up prose publishing, which is more by the numbers. I thought we could do something a little bit differently here. And Silence in the Library had proven they could get a lot of funds up front and by doing this, and that's what ended up working out. So it was a good kind of early boost plus buzz plus money, which, you know, Silence in the Library is a small bit of the...
You actually have a couple people in the chat room who said they backed it and that they're a Twitch backer. That's awesome.
Yeah, I do. I had a number of people, and there was a big delay that was just... It's a long story, but it comes down to art takes a while.
Yes, especially so, when you're working with artists like that. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah, that...
Yeah. As so they were very patient, I guess, is my point. The backers were very patient. Like, really, they were really patient. And since many of them were people hanging out on my Twitch channel, I was always like, so here's where we stand. I'm not running away from you because I'm here. Like, it got progressively more me apologizing over and over again because I felt bad that we had delays. But we did. I'm proud of what we came up with and with the future of this series. But they were really, really, the backers were awesome. So
nice, nice.
Yeah.
Any more you want to throw his way?
I was going to say that's kind of awesome because I never thought about how Twitch can be used as a tool to communicate with people, because a lot of the times when projects get slowed down, especially with indie stuff that happens a lot more often, you actually can still communicate with people, and it's not like, oh, it's gone dark or what's happening, what happened to this. So that's awesome that you stream.
Well, especially that's totally true. I mean, I do some dev interviews on mine with indie developers of video game stuff focused on story and narrative, and they've talked quite a bit about how the problem of people feeling burned by Kickstarter are the people who just like vanish. You know, they produce something and then they just leave. And I kind of was horrified. I was like, under what circumstances would I ever do that? But they were like, oh yeah, we're used to it. The thing that surprised me more was that people were not upset about this delay. They were like, oh yeah, actually you're a little bit ahead of the game. And I'm like, I'm sorry. And they're like, oh, most of the time these things are like 3 years or they never come up. They were just very philosophical about it. And I'm like, that's wrong. Like, no one should be this philosophical about being unprofessional, you know, but But things happen, as you say. So yeah, Twitch was really good to keep me visible. I was never going to run away. I'll just say that. So.
Well, having that close of a connection to your community, did the community shape the story in any way? Or did you ever have to reevaluate certain aspects when you started getting that kind of community involvement?
That's a really good question. Not really, because by the time I brought it to them, much of the sort of script and everything was baked in. But later rollouts of it, for example, the audio version I mentioned, that I actually threw in because I felt so bad for the delay that I was like, I want to give something to the backers free. So I ended up having I have a voiceover team that does voiced over versions of games like Aviary Attorney and Phoenix Wright and stuff like this, that goes once a month on my channel. And so I managed to pull a couple of those in, Trending and George, because I was like, can we do this just for something to give to the backers? And then it ended up being so awesome. I just heard their voices and I'm like, this is the coolest thing I've ever heard. That we ended up doing a full soundtrack for it with another guy, Matt Van Roon, who's also a streamer over at GOGcom.twitch, who's a musician and a visual effects guy. And he ended up doing a motion comic thing, which we're going to sort of roll out, which came out amazingly well. So all of these things that I hadn't planned on initially were all supplemented by this sort of connection with Twitch. So in that sense, like, you know, post-production and like all these things that happen afterwards, that totally was supported by Twitch, which was amazing. I have many good things to say about Twitch. Like, of all the things I've done as a writer, the best thing beyond conventions and conferences and stuff like that, the best sort of promotional tool that I've found has been Twitch, one way or the other.
Awesome. Yeah, there's something about that direct connection to the people who enjoy your content that's really interesting. Where can people find...
It's like, and it's direct, it's immediate.
Yeah, it's immediate. Where can people find Icarus for all the people in our chat room that are wanting to check it out?
So it's available in two places. I can throw a link in chat, which I will do. It is available, first of all, here. Whoops. I got to be permitted. I forgot.
Nightbot.
Sorry, Nightbot.
Mod, permit him. Mod, permit him.
I apologize, Nightbot. Yeah, exactly.
Give them 30 seconds and they'll permit you.
Yeah, okay. That's cool. There it is. Thank you. So that's the first link. That link goes to the Audible version, which is the audio, the paperback, and the Kindle version of this. And then it's also available directly through Silence and the Library Publishing, which I think, as I realize to my horror that I don't have that up yet. Hold on. I'll find it. Silence and the Library Publishing. Right. Silenceandthelibrarypublishing.com. So it's just silenceandthelibrarypublishing.com, which I don't want to... I don't want Nightbot to come, you know, to go foul of me, but that's the other place they can get it directly. And yeah, they can get it direct from Amazon or direct from the publisher. And also my website over at gregoryawilson.com has links to all that stuff too.
Awesome. So you guys should definitely check out the book, and you should also check out his Twitch channel. I saw somebody say something in there with you do like live choose your own adventure stories with people on Twitch.
Yeah.
That's really awesome.
I do a live thing of Fighting Fantasy game book. You know, the old Choose Your Own Adventure, but like the Ian Livingstone, the Wizard, like Warlock of Firetop Mountain. I don't know if you know that kind of stuff, but that whole series. I've been doing one of those once a month on my channel. Oh gosh, we're up to like book 22 or 23.
Oh wow.
Yeah, and I've had people who like, you know, coded up a bot to like make it easier. It's fun. I mean, I love Dungeons and Dragons and I love that kind of stuff. I do regular campaigns on my channel too, and it's all the same thing. It's all story and narrative, and I'm a storyteller and I love telling stories in different venues. So,
that's the most fun aspect of Twitch to me. Being able to tell a story with live feedback is really cool.
Yeah, no, I love that kind of thing, and it's fun to see it being. I mean, I should say that I love Harebrained Schemes. I love Mitch. I did a live voiceover thing with them last year on the Shadowrun Hong Kong.
Oh, cool.
And yeah, so I love those guys, and part of why I love them is because I think they really know how to focus on story and narrative. And listen, anyone who can somehow implement Snuggle Lord and make it a legitimate part, I mean, that's storytelling 101, you know?
I don't know about 101. That's more like -5 or something like that. Like, it's pretty low hanging fruit there. But thanks so much, Greg, for coming out and talking to us. And you guys should definitely check out the Icarus. It was a really fun read. I read both issues this morning, and awesome. We were talking about it earlier.
It's beautiful, too. It's gorgeous.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm really happy with the art. They did a great job. And thank you guys for having me. I really appreciate it. Hyper RPGs is a great channel. So thank you guys for having me.
Sweet, man. Thank you for saying that. And if you're ever in town, stop by. We'll throw you on a show.
Yeah, my wife's from Seattle, so I may...
We'll make you a villain. We love having villains come in. So
sign me up. I got the mustache going. I'm ready.
Sweet. So we're going to go ahead and sign off with you here, Greg. But in a second, when we finish up closing out the show, I'm going to play those YouTube videos you sent me, which are some previews, correct, of the motion comic?
Yeah, those are the previews of the motion comic. And I should say, by the way, for everyone, that the guy who did the music and the visual effects, again, his name is Matt Van Roon, also has a soundtrack of this available over at Bandcamp. And as here, I think. So I want to...
You might have to post that in chat. We did give you the ability to share links because Skype was being Skype again there for a little bit. But
Okay. I'll do that as you guys are watching.
Thank you so much, man. And all right, guys. So we're going to sign off here with Greg and sign out of the episode, I guess.
Yeah.
We got really real earlier.
We did.
We got heavy as shit.
It was good. I liked it. It was, yeah.
I like to argue. So if you like to argue, this is going to be fun. It's going to be fun. And we're not always going to agree. We came to an agreement today.
We did. You know what's cool? We started out disagreeing. That's what happens when you have respectful discourse.
And what's funny is I didn't even try to convince you to change your opinion.
It just happened through natural conversation.
You were just talking and then we're like, you know what? That's weird. Because I don't see that happening very often.
You'd be surprised.
We'll disagree a lot, but I respect your opinion.
I respect yours, too.
I never hear that often.
Well, I respect you as that's a person and as an individual, Zach.
I'm used to just being like, fuck you, Zach. And I'm like, oh, okay. That's I get it. It's fine.
I think I also I respect Zach so much because we both kind of have a little bit of the douchebag reputation. Just a little bit. Don't you think? We can be really blunt.
Blunt.
Yeah.
Blunt.
Blunt is better than douchebag.
I just like making people second guess their judgments on me.
We even have the same basic pose right now. We're basically twins.
Twinsies. So come back next week, and it'll be the first edition of our new show that is going to be basically this, but different because we're going to say it's different.
I made it through my first episode!
Yay! Congratulations! Well done. You did something fairly simple. But Bronze Girl, Zach really is a douchebag. Troll. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, anyway, we're going to move on. I'm going to play these YouTube videos, Joe, so don't just go to the wait screen. I'm going to play these on the big screen. You go full screen on it if you want. And we will be getting ready for the next show, which is watching paint dry. So thank you for coming out today.
Yeah.
And thank you guys for letting us talk shop and talk about comic books. So stick around. I'm going to show these videos. Bye. Hyper D-bags. Great. Yeah. No. Great. Make these full screen.
Scratch. How are we going to make it if we don't have something to sell? Nah, I'm not gonna hear it, you. You don't do all that much work, you know?
Awesome. Joe, how do you...
Yeah. Of all, no matter how many times I tell him that Peller spikes come out after you swallow them, he still eats the damn things. But on a good solar cycle, he'll get as many as 10 flame petals. That goes a long way. Lately, though, we've been coming up pretty light. 2, 3, maybe 4 on a good solar cycle. And I was starting to get worried. I got bills to pay, you know? We were taking a break after trudging near to the Central Plains. Mountains rose to the north, up where some fools say the Firbargs live. To the south, the lava pools with the Salamander Kings. Far in the distance, the East Plains. And beyond them, the Hole. We'd never been out this far before, and all we had to show for it was a big fat nothing. My dad would have told me I was being a damn fool, probably. He was a prospector, like me, but he hated every cycle of it. What he really loved doing was crafting. Then he was gone. And what was I supposed to do but try to live like him? except for the crafting part, which I ain't too good at. But truth be told, I'm nothing like him. People liked him. Best I can do is keep my head down and keep out of the way. Come on, Rig, what's with all the yelling? Oh, no. Soul's blood. A flame demon. You don't usually see him this far west. I knew I was done for, but I felt sorry for Rig. It wasn't his fault I wasn't paying attention. Wouldn't you know it? A damn fool Solar thought he could do something against a flame demon. Surprised the flame demon hadn't made a move yet. But maybe he just couldn't decide which one of us he was gonna eat first. Or maybe he was just having some fun, you know, like he was playing with his food before he ate it. Come on now, you don't want none of Rig here. You let him go and deal with me. I got what you want. What the? That right there was how I first met Icky. That kid knew how to make an entrance. Even now, I can't explain what it was like to see it stand. But this expression on its face, kinda serene, like it knew what was gonna happen. Cause that demon comes up swinging and screaming, you know, and in it comes.
No!
All of a sudden, those wings glowed blue and light shot out all over the place. Entrances, I tell you. That kid knew how to make an entrance.